हेलो सर।
हेलो राजा। ಲೈವ್ ಐತೆ ನೀಗ ಇನ್ನ ಆಗಿಲ್ಲಲ್ಲ
ಈಗ ಮಾಡ್ತೀವಿ ಸರ್ ಈಗ ಆನ್ ಟ್ಯೂಬ್ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಆನ್ ಯೂಟ್ಯೂಬ್ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಮಾಡ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದೀವಿ ಸರ್ ಈಗ
ಹೌದಾ ಓಕೆ
ಸುಮಿದಕ್ಕೆ ಕನೆಕ್ಷನ್ ಕೊಡ್ತೀರಿ ಇದು ಬರೋದು ಅಂತಿರಲ್ಲ ಮತ್ತೆ ಅದು ಇರಲಿ ಆನ್ ಆಫ್ ಮಾಡ್ರಿ ಬಟ್ ಬರ್ತದ ಸೌಂಡ್ ಸಿಸ್ಟಮ್ ಅದು ಅದರ ಸೌಂಡ್ ಇಲ್ಲ Shall we start, sir?
Hey, no problem. No, ready.
Respected esteemed faculty, Dr. Ravi Kirti M. sir, respected senior delegates, respected senior colleagues, and my dear friends. Sir, am I audible to you?
Yeah, you're audible. Yeah.
At the outset, I welcome you all for this monthly series, guest lecture series from the Department of Geriatric Medicine and Association of Physicians of India, Bijapur chapter, Bijapur branch. A very good afternoon to all of you. So I, Dr. Anand Ambli, on the behalf of BLD Deemed University, Sri B.A. Patil Medical College Hospital and Research Center, I thank Dr. Ravi Kirti sir for being with us. And also, we have Dr. Rajesh Honudigi, sir, who is the Vice President of API Karnataka chapter, and my dear students, colleagues from all over Karnataka who have joined here. I welcome you again. Our Honorable Vice Chancellor, sir, Dr. M.S. Biradar, beloved Principal, Dr. Arvind Patil, sir, has conveyed their best wishes for this program. We here at the Geriatric Clinic, which was started way back in 2007, in our constant endeavor, we are creating awareness regarding geriatric medicine among the residents of postgraduate students of medicine as well as undergraduate students. In continuity of this, today's program is arranged to create awareness regarding the common medical problems in older people. Today, we have distinguished faculty, Dr. Ravi Kirti M. from Bengaluru. He is presently director Internal Medicine, Kaveri Hospital and V2K Hospital Clinic at Bengaluru. He is also a governing body member of Association of Physicians of India from 2020 to 2023. He was a joint secretary of Indian College of Physicians for the year 2018 and 19. He was joint organ secretary of EpiCon 2018. He is the past secretary and treasurer and executive committee member of API Karnataka chapter. He is professor of medicine at BMC and Research Institute Bengaluru and SDUMC Kollar. He has also served as a consultant physician to Manipal Hospitals, BGS Global Hospital, and hospital at Abu Dhabi. So I now request Dr. Ravi Kirti, sir. Before that, we like to invite Dr. Rajesh Honodigi, sir, Vice President, Association Physician of India Karnataka Chapter, to declare this program open.
Good afternoon, my dear colleagues and my dear students. First of all, it's a very great pleasure, especially because today's guest is Dr. Ravi Kirti. He is a very good friend of mine, and he was my colleague during my postgraduate days in JNMC Belgaum. So nice to have you, sir, virtually. Next time we'll have you physically. it's very nice. In next 30-35 minutes, he is going to discuss about common problems in elderly, because they are different from young people. So the approach towards elderly is different. So in continuation with the series of guest talks in geriatric medicine, today we have Dr. Ravi Kirti, who is a eminent speaker and also is a governing body member and past secretary of Karnataka State API chapter. I also take this opportunity to thank Dr. Anand Amli for continuing this guest lecture series, and he is one of the pioneer in establishing geriatric clinic, and probably we may have Department of Geriatric Medicine in future. So I congratulate Dr. Anand Amli for taking this initiation, and now I request Dr. Ravi Kirti to go ahead with his talk.
Over to you, sir. Oh,
thank you, Dr. Rajesh and Dr. Anand. At the outset, my sincere thanks to the Department of Internal Medicine, BLDA Medical College, and Geriatric Medicine for giving me this opportunity. And I would like to thank my friends Rajesh and Dr. Anand for having me here. When Dr. Anand asked me to give a guest talk, I was thinking, so something different I need to speak, because every time we get to hear, either diabetes or hypertension, not more than that actually. That let me have something different so that I also can learn. And in the beginning itself, my sincere apologies, I am not that great speaker, but I'll try to do what is possible. And today's topic, what I have chosen, is the common problems in elderly. As all of us know that everybody has to grow old one or other day, which is a must. So, and I'm sure that many people will not accept the aging. Everybody wants to stay young also, actually. Like everybody wants to stay young all the time. Unfortunately, that is not in our hands. It's a natural process, except for some bacteria and some plants which remain young always. And when it comes to the human beings, so the when it comes to the aging, by definition, it is a progressive universal decline, first in the functional reserve, then in the functions that occurs in all organisms over a period of time. And it is a basically a heterogeneous process. It is not a disease. However, the risk of developing the disease is increased with the aging. With the aging, mortality increases because of the many causes. Biochemical changes takes place in the tissues. It reduces the physiological capacity. It reduces the ability to adapt to the environment, increases the susceptibility to the disease. And the rate of aging is affected by genes, lifestyle, and environment. That is why if you start the good, healthy lifestyle in the beginning itself, we can delay the process of the aging and maintain a good, healthy lifestyle during the advanced age also. With a normal aging, these are the some changes that we can expect. That is, the height reduces by 5 centimeters by 75 years, and body fat increases, lean body mass has come down, and it also reduces the body water content. It increases the dry skin, and also it increases the stiffness due to reduced water content in the tendons and ligaments, and also reduces the remodeling. With the aging, the brain weight comes down by 20%, and blood flow to the brain comes down. It slows the processing time and reduces the renal mass by 25 to 30% by the age of 80, and reduces the lung elastic capacity. And we tend to use, the elderly tend to use the abdominal muscles, which usually we don't use in an adult age group, where we basically depend on the thoracic muscles for the respiration. So with the aging, swallowing also is less coordinated. It reduces the absorption of almost all the vitamin, food and minerals. said initially, like, I don't want to talk about the cardiovascular disease and the cancers, because we will be discussing about all these things in many other platforms. So let us consider the other factors. And I'll be going little only brief into most of the conditions. I'll not go in depth into the thing because it's a large topic. So coming to the infections, commonest, most of the time bacterial infections are very common in the elderly, especially above the age of 65 years. And pneumonia is one of the commonest infections. And the other common infections are recurrent UTIs, intra-abdominal infections, and also the pressure sore infections. When it comes to the respiratory infections, why the risk of the pneumonia and lung infections are common? So some of the common reasons are reduced cough and other protective reflexes, reduced lung elasticity, mucociliary clearance is reduced, Ig levels in the respiratory secretions are reduced, and increased level of the circulating inflammatory cytokines and malnutrition. All these things leads to increased risk and the frequency of pneumonia in the elderly, that is almost 4 to 11 times in the people more than 65 years. And they'll have a more severe disease and high mortality. Co-infections are more frequently seen in elderly, especially admitted, those who are admitted to ICU with the influenza. More resistant bacteria as a causative agents of the pneumonia. Mortality secondary to ventilator-associated pneumonia is higher in patients who are more than 65 years. Duration of the ICU stay is also more, and mechanical ventilation is also longer. Weaning from the mechanical ventilation is more difficult. How do we prevent these things? So one of the ways is annual influenza vaccination, pneumococcal vaccination, careful observation of the drug interactions and toxicities, and drug dosage adjustment according to the accompanying comorbidities. And the second most common infection that we said is the urinary tract infections. This can happen because of the mechanical changes, that is a reduced bladder capacity, involuntary contractions, decreased urinary flow, urinary stasis due to prostate hypertrophy or the bladder prolapse, and urothelial changes, which leads to high prevalence of bacteriuria, increased bacterial adhesion to the uroepithelium. So this can be avoided by unnecessary urinary catheterization and also avoiding treatment of the asymptomatic bacteriuria. And the third commonest infection that we come across is the skin and soft tissue infections. So malnutrition increases the risk of the skin and soft tissue infections, increased catabolism, collagen subcutaneous tissue loss, decreased size of the blood vessels in the dermis, decreased water binding capacity of the stratum corneum, decreased derma epidermal adhesions, decreased mobility and a bedridden status, all increases the risk of the slows down the process of healing and increases the incidence of the bed sores and the pressure sores. So this can be minimized by prolonged pressures, keeping the skin dry and clean, that can prevent the skin and soft tissue infection to some extent. And the other common things that we come across is one is the bacteremia and sepsis, immunosuppression due to immunosenescence, and the frequent use of IV lines in the critically ill patient. All these things leads to increased bacteremia and sepsis. So unnecessary use of IV catheter insertion and prompt removal as indicated by the type of the bacteria and the fungemia can prevent the complications. And the other commonest thing is the clostridial infection, because of the decreased gastric acidity and intestinal motility leads to changes in the intestinal microbiome. And it slows the recovery of the microbiome after the antibiotic usage. So this leads to higher mortality and morbidity, and there will be more and more recurrence of the cases and also more severe disease. So it's better to avoid the prolonged antibiotic usage in the patient and in the elderly, so that we can prevent these infections. So coming to the pneumonia, more than 50% of the pneumonias over 65 years are community acquired and bacterial. One of the commonest agent that is responsible for the pneumonia is the Streptococcus pneumonia. And in the setting of the COPD, the commonest organisms seen are Haemophilus influenza, Moraxella catarrhalis, and Legionella pneumonia. So we do come across Chlamydophila pneumonia and viruses including influenza, rhinovirus, and human metapneumovirus that can be detected. And most of the time, the elderly will have an atypical presentation. The classical presentation of fever, sore throat, running nose, cough may not be there. They can directly present with either a severe chest pain or an abrupt onset of the breathlessness. So and lack of fever is also seen in elderly patient. This is a grave prognostic sign, especially in elderly when there is no fever, without fever, patient presenting with a pneumonia. The second most common infection is a UTI. So normally in 5 to 10% of the women aged above 65 years, asymptomatic bacteria is seen. And more than 5% of the men also asymptomatic bacteria is seen. So elderly patients may have urinary source of infection in almost up to 30% of the cases. And E. coli is usually the most commonest infectious agent, followed by Candida, Enterococcus, and Pseudomonas aeruginosa. Urinary catheter colonization frequently occurs after the hospitalization. Thus, the urine sample should always be obtained after replacing the urinary catheter. So coming to the next topic after the infections is the delirium and dementia. Dementia, as we know, it's a syndrome of progressive decline in which multiple intellectual abilities deteriorate, causing both cognitive and functional impairment. Delirium is a state of acute confusion. So it is important to differentiate between the delirium and dementia, as both have got a different prognosis. So and dementia is a state of chronic confusion. So both dementia and delirium are characterized by disorientation, memory impairment, paranoia, hallucinations, emotional lability, and a disturbed sleep-wake cycle, or the reversal of the sleep-wake cycle. So as I said, delirium is acute in onset. They'll have an impaired attention and also have an altered level of the consciousness. So what is the role of a physician when it comes to the dementia? So the main goal of the care of the patient with the dementia is to improve the cognitive and the physical functioning. The key goal is to identify and treat the reversible causes of the cognitive impairment, such as infections, electrolyte abnormalities, vitamin deficiencies, thyroid disease, substance abuse, medication, and the psychiatric illness. So let us consider the few conditions which are responsible for the delirium. The one of the most commonest that we come across in day-to-day clinical setup is a hyponatremia. So hyponatremia is defined as a plasma sodium of less than 135 millimoles. Its prevalence is estimated to be around 18 to 23.3% in the elderly population, according to some studies. So it's basically caused by mainly caused by the drugs, and more frequently the thyroids and antidepressants, and also the syndrome of inappropriate ADH secretion, and also the endocrinopathies. So phenothiazines, butorphanols, benzodiazepines, mirtazapine, and antidepressants are the main causes of this hyponatremia. The female gender, low body mass index, low baseline serum sodium, concomitant non-psychiatric medication use, especially the diuretics, NSAIDs, proton pump inhibitors, AC inhibitors, as well as the presence of heart failure, malignancy, liver disease, and adrenal insufficiency, all these things increases the risk of the hyponatremia. Carbamazepine and doxcarbazepine are the most commonest anti-epileptic drugs that are responsible for hyponatremia. In fact, the studies have shown that valproic acid, phenytoin, topiramate have a high risk of being hospitalization with the hyponatremia. And secondary adrenal insufficiency is one of the frequently overlooked cause of the endocrinal cause of the hyponatremia. Diabetes also causes hypovolemic hyponatremia. Other common, uncommon thing that we see is something called as T-toast syndrome that occurs in elderly individuals with a low GFR who follow a diet poor in salt and protein, but drink a large amount of the water. So there is a low distal delivery of the filtrate and increased water reabsorption due to the low rate of the osmosis excretion. So let's come to the other commonest cause of delirium, that is a hyperosmolar hyperglycemic coma. So we all will be discussing about diabetic ketoacidosis, but we always tend to neglect this hyperosmolar coma in many of the cases. So the studies have shown that average age of the patients with a hyperosmolar hyperglycemic state is almost 60 years. Any living situation or a comorbidity that prevents adequate hydration, including, for example, the immobility, advanced age, debility, dementia, agitation, impaired thirst response, restricted access to water, and restrained use, place in these patients at the increased risk of developing the hyperosmolar status. So the diagnosis is usually made by the plasma, estimation of the plasma glucose level of more than 600 milligram per deciliter. When usually they'll have more than 600 milligram of blood sugar, and effective serum osmolality of more than 320, and a profound dehydration almost up to average of 9 liters, and serum pH should be more than 7.3, and bicarbonate concentrations are more than 15. They can have a small ketonuria, but ketonuria, but absent to low ketonemia. So there will be they can also have a altered state of consciousness. The main goals of the treatment in this hyperosmolar state is as follows. We have to vigorously rehydrate the patient while maintaining the electrolyte homeostasis, to correct the hyperglycemia, to treat the underlying disease, to monitor and assist the cardiovascular, pulmonary, renal, and the central nervous system functions. So the next commonest thing that we see in the elderly is a depression. One of the commonest, common in the elderly patient in a primary care setting, that is almost, the incidence is almost 17 to 37%. In a hospitalized patient, it may be up to 25%. Patient often deny the depression mode. They will have a sleep disturbances, reduced appetite, weight loss, withdrawal, anxiousness, and more common with dementia patients. The next common condition that we come across is osteoporosis. Low bone density with a increased susceptibility to the fractures, and asymptomatic until the fracture starts occurring. They'll be asymptomatic until the fracture start occurring. Initially can affect the vertebral bodies, distal radius, proximal femur, and pelvis. And one third of the woman will have at least one vertebral fracture. The major risk factors are female sex, elderly age, estrogen deficiency, white or Asian race, inactivity, and slight stature, smoking, alcohol, chronic steroid abuse or anticonvulsant usage, inadequate calcium intake, reduced sun exposure, liver disease, and hypothyroidism are the risk factors. So some steps towards the prevention, that is the regular weight bearing exercises that anybody needs to continue. And daily calcium intake 1200 milligrams are required, and vitamin D 2000 international units daily, and smoking cessation, medical therapy in those with a low bone mineral density who are at the high risk of developing the osteoporosis, and taking care of the fall prevention. And prevention ideally always starts in the childhood. The next commonest condition is a fall. So this excludes the fall from the seizures, stroke, and a syncope. The fall rates and the risk of injury increases with age. Almost 30% of the community dwelling adults of above 65 years will have a history of fall. And while the 50% of the individuals more than 80, almost it, the incident reaches almost up to 80% when the age crosses 80 years. Most of the falls are multifactorial, and it can be a symptom of another disease also, especially like infections, neurological disorder, medication side effects, and age-related physiologic changes. The major physiologic changes that takes place in the elderly are the decreased proprioception, increased postural swaying, decline in the baroreflex sensitivity, resulting in the orthostatic hypotension. The risk factors for the fall are muscle weakness, gait or balance abnormality, use of walking aid, visual impairment, arthritis, impaired activities of the daily living. And depression, cognitive impairment, age over 80 years, and also the polypharmacy. So when it comes to the polypharmacy, so all of us know that by the time anyone reaches 60 years, they will have a multiple comorbidities. Here I would like to show a slide which has been sent by one of our senior teachers, where we can see the example. It's basically an example. So you look at this slide. Almost he has got a 12 comorbidities. Name anything he has got here. Diabetes, hypertension, dyslipidemia, retinitis pigmentosa, and 12 multiple diagnoses. And this is the number of medication that he is taking. So it is very difficult to treat an elderly patient. So because we need to keep drug interactions into the mind, and what is the dosage that is required, all those things to the mind. So all these things, polypharmacy will increase the risk of the fall. So how do we approach? So when we start evaluating the patient, we should always start with a history like in any other condition. So you should take the circumstances that at the time of the fall, and what were the associated symptoms, and a thorough medication review, both the prescription and also the over-the-counter medication that the person has consumed. And good physical examination should include the postural vital signs, evaluation of the vision, gait and balance testing, and a musculoskeletal examination that is to examine the joint stability and the range of movement, motion. And also we need to have an environmental assessment, especially around the patient where he is living, that where they can have loose carpets which can lead to the fall, and also the poor lighting also is one of the major causes for the fall. So next most common thing that is seen in the common problem that is seen in the elderly is the urinary incontinence. So it is one of the major problems for the older adults. Up to the age of 80, urinary incontinence affects women more than the men. After the age, after 80, both sexes are equally affected. What are the risk factors for this urinary incontinence? One is the advanced age. Next one is the functional impairment, dementia, obesity, smoking, affective disorders, and constipation. Urinary incontinence can occur in four different ways. That is, one is a stress incontinence, urge incontinence, mixed stress and urge incontinence, and also the overflow incontinence. So how do we approach the urinary incontinence? So we need to measure the postvital residual urine volume that should be measured as a part of the incontinence evaluation in all the patient. Under sterile condition, the patient bladder is catheterized 5 to 10 minutes after the patient has voided. Generally, post volume residue should be more than 200 to suggest that there is a detrus or inactivity or a obstruction, and the patient should be referred for the urological evaluation. Stress incontinence, that is a urethral sphincter mechanisms are inadequate to hold the urine during the bladder filling, which is less common in men compared to the women. Leaking small amounts of the urine during the activities that increases the intra-abdominal pressure, such as a cough, coughing, laughing, sneezing, lifting, and standing. And small bedside test strips can be performed by the patient standing with a full bladder, and we can ask them to cough. The test is considered positive if the urine is leakage coincides with the cough. So it is most common in women due to the insufficient pelvic support. So that is maybe because of the multiple childbirths and gynecological surgeries that reduces the decreased effects of the estrogen on the tissues of the lower urinary tract. So the treatment for the stress incontinence is pelvic muscle exercises that can be helpful. Then the surgical interventions are the most effective treatment, and treatment failure higher in patients who have two or more leakages per day. Coming to the urge incontinence, is also known as detrus or overactivity, and is characterized by uninhibited bladder, and is the most common form of urinary incontinence in the elderly. Increased urinary frequency and nocturnal incontinence are also common in this condition. So urge incontinence may be idiopathic, or it can be because of the lesions of the central nervous system, or it can be because of the bladder irritation from the infection, stones, or the tumors. So coming to the treatment, the bladder retraining by the encouraging the patient to void every 2 hours are based on the patient symptom frequency. And the patient can also try urgency control. If no incontinence for 2 days, then voiding interval can be increased by 30 to 60 minutes until the patient is only voiding every 3 to 4 hours. So some of the drugs that can be used are oxybutynin and also tolterodine. Patients using tolterodine have a reduced risk of a dry mouth and a fever withdrawal due to the side effects. And also other condition, as I said, it's a mixed incontinence. So they can have a mixed incontinence, refers to urinary incontinence symptoms of both stress as well as a urge incontinence. Coming to the overflow incontinence, that is due to either the bladder outlet obstruction or a atonic bladder, which is much more common in men compared to the women. On physical examination, they can have a palpable distended bladder. So some of the common causes for the overflow incontinence in a male are prostatic hypertrophy, prostatic cancer, urethral stricture, and in females it is a cystocele. Detrus or inactivity or underactivity can be caused by spinal cord lesions, autonomic neuropathy, diabetes, alcoholism, vitamin B12 deficiency, Parkinson's disease, and tapes nasales. So this drugs that can be used in the treatment are adrenergic blockers like terazosin, doxazosin, tamsulosin, and 5 reductase inhibitors like finasteride. Diagnosis of functional incontinence can be done in individual who have urinary incontinence and have either cognitive or a functional impairment which limit their ability to use the toilet themselves. So coming to the other common common medical problem, that is a bed sores, and that is a pressure sores. So it's also known as a pressure sore, bed sore, or a decubitus ulcers, occurs in elderly patients who has got a reduced mobility. A pressure ulcer occurs when the increased pressure between the skin and the bony prominence produces tissue necrosis, while the pressure ulcers can occur anywhere in the body. 80% of the pressure ulcers occur over the heels, lateral malleoli, sacrum, ischia, and greater trochanter. Osteomyelitis and sepsis are an important and morbid complications of the pressure ulcers. This is a picture which shows the different types of the pressure ulcers in a patient. So some of the ways to prevent is a frequent change of position, and especially for the patient who are at risk, keep changing the patient position every 1 hour, and providing the bed-bound patients with the mattresses with a pressure relieving capabilities are standard interventions to prevent the pressure ulcers. The skin of the elderly may bruise easily, causing the senile purpura. Some people will have skin that is almost like a transparent tissue paper, which is also known as papyraceous skin, especially in the back of the hand and forearm. So this is a picture which shows the papyraceous skin as well as a senile purpura. So coming to the next commonest problem, probably this is one of the highest when it comes to the percentage, probably this is what the highest number that we see is, that is a constipation is another commonest. So to prevent the constipation, increase the fluid intake, ask them to do exercise daily, and increase the fiber intake. So some of the complications also with the constipation are hemorrhoids, anal fissure, rectal prolapse, and fecal impaction. Next common complication is a postural hypotension. So this can be a warning sign. There can be a warning sign that is with a history of dizziness, fainting, and the visual disturbances. So some of the measures that we can take to prevent the postural hypotension are to get out of the bed slowly and in stages, sleep with the head of the bed elevated a few inches above the ground. Daily fluid intake should be 2 to 3 liters. Avoid hot showers or baths, which may cause venous dilatation, thereby causing the peripheral venous pooling and causing the postural hypotension. Avoid straining during defecation. This may also cause the reducing the blood pressure. Avoid bending down and suddenly standing up, and rest for 60 minutes after each meal. Avoid hyperventilation, which also because it also reduces the blood pressure. Exercise regimen should be recommended, and use of thigh-length elastic stockings reduces the venous pooling, and patient should be asked to avoid prolonged standing. The next common problem that we come across in elderly is a hearing impairment. Almost sensory neural hearing loss of 25% to 30% will be seen in elderly patients, and most of them are associated with the noise exposure. Usually, high frequency loss is more common. Emotional difficulties and cognitive impairments are seen, and there will be reduced physical functioning in these people. And the next commonest thing is the vision. So with the aging, the lens elasticity comes down. Adoption will be more slower to the light, and the night vision decreases, and visual acuity also comes down, field of vision also comes down, and the contrast sensitivity also comes down. They'll have an increased sensitivity to the glare. So this is how a picture like we can see from the picture, what we can see at the age of 20 years, how the picture appears, and at the 6 years, how it appears, and at 78, how it becomes blur. Some of the other common causes for the visual impairment in the elderly are cataract, macular degeneration, diabetic retinopathy, and glaucoma. So some measures that we can say taking in terms of poor vision are the bright illumination, increase the contrast, magnification, and low vision clinics, patient can be referred to low vision clinics, and word processing programs can be suggested. To summarize, the treatment in the elderly is more complex, and we should always treat any elderly with a respect and use the drugs carefully. As I said in the beginning, so the aging can be, and the healthy lifestyle can be maintained with in the elderly also. So I would like to end the talk with two good quotes. That is, we do not quit playing because we grow old. We grow old because we quit playing. And always we should add life to our days, but not days to our life. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. This was an precise description of common medical problems. You have included the pathogenesis, clinical features, and management, what we call as end-to-end of all the common medical problems in the older people. That was very precise and most helpful to our residents who are participating in this program. Now, this program is open for question and answer session. Any questions anybody has? Yes, any of the, so we have around 26 residents here from medicine department who are offline. And any questions from anybody? So the immunization regarding influenza and pneumococcal, can you please throw some light on that, sir?
I think so. In India, the vaccination in elderly is still not that active. The awareness itself is very low. Probably we need to consider that as a serious, like a childhood immunization program. We should make it mandatory so that people are protected actually.
Yes, sir. Regarding polypharmacy, you mentioned sometimes it is inevitable and sometimes it is inappropriate. What we call as a physician, we take as inappropriate medications, which can be stopped. So can you highlight something on that?
Yeah, I think most of the prescriptions, what we can see is either they contain a proton pump inhibitor, multiple number of multivitamins, and multiple sedatives actually. Those things are not required. So when a elderly, because always they'll have a multiple comorbidities, use the drugs that is only required, and we can avoid the drugs that are not required actually.
Yes, sir. Regarding the hyperosmolar or non-ketotic coma, most of the time it is delayed diagnosis. And as you mentioned rightly, there is an increased mortality too. So anything that from your experience that you like to share where we can identify it early?
I think, see, any person who comes with a history or without a history, elderly person who comes with an altered sensorium or coma, first thing we have to do the blood sugars and make sure when the blood sugar is higher, we should always consider this as one of the possibilities. Instead of thinking only diabetic ketoacidosis, this also should be considered in the diagnosis, because the treatment is going to be entirely different and we can save the patient almost 100% of the time.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you very much for this lucid discussion. And I think definitely our postgraduate students and residents get benefit of it. You have covered very diligently the commonest medical issues that we come across in older people. I now request Dr. Vanuti sir to give a presidential remarks.
Thanks to Dr. Ravi Kirti for his wonderful talk regarding common problems in elderly, the approach towards the patient, the differential diagnosis. Definitely, it is going to be helpful for our postgraduate students. And further, we hope to have further topics regularly under this heading with cooperation of API Bijapur chapter and Department of Medicine, BLDS BM Patel Medical College. We'll have regular report. Thank you.
So I take this privileged opportunity on the behalf of BLD Deemed University Department of Medicine and on the behalf of our Honorable Vice Chancellor and Principal Sir to thank you immensely for sharing your wisdom and being with us, accepting our invitation at the very short time. And we thank you for sharing. And as you rightly commented that geriatric medicine, you also wanted to share your experiences. And we are thankful for that. On the behalf of university, we convey our sincere thanks to you for being with us and sharing your wisdom. And I thank all the delegates who have participated offline and online on this program. Thank you all very much for this. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.